Hello my friends, it's me again, Dr. Nitro and 8-Bomb Custom Guitar Workshop. Today I'll tell you about Relic. This video is translated as usual, так что если вы хотите посмотреть этот ролик на русском языке, кликайте сюда. Replicas and Relic. These two topics have both followers and opponents. Anyway, anyone has the right for their own opinion. It's a matter of taste, personal preferences and associations. Those who know about these two topics encourage me. Those who don't have a clue will get something new for themselves. So, let's go! Relic appeared comparatively not long ago. There's a story that this trend of art was invented by Keith Richards, who ordered at Fender Custom Shop a pair of aged guitars. Later on, other musicians picked up this idea, as taking on tour original vintage and expensive instruments that sometimes cost more than $100,000 seems not so safe. Who knows what can happen to so much loved instrument? That's why it's more convenient to tour with some cheap workhorses, which are comfortable enough and look the same as vintage ones. After all, you have to look true on stage. Relic became a necessity, fashion, and a kind of philosophy, like hot rod cars or bobber bikes. One needs to grow into Relic, and one needs to get used to it. It's the same as learning to value a race of single malt whiskey or gain an understanding of arts. Everything happens as time goes by. A young man buys his first electric guitar at the shop. It's new, looks great, no marks, chrome is shining. He carefully starts learning to play, trying not to scratch. But now he's experienced enough, plays in a band, and this guitar is a working instrument that he doesn't let go. This guitar gets marks of battle glory. He got used to it, the guitar feels the same. On stage they are as one. The guitar now looks old and proficient. It's obvious that it's used by a professional. It has its own story. It's not that shoppy candy that doesn't differ from any other things in the shop. Now it's an instrument that creates music. This is one side of Relic, natural one, but it takes time. Artificial Relic calls for the look and comfort of a vintage guitar and helps it to reveal the whole potential of resonance. So why do people like Relic guitars more than new ones, right from the store? I can tell you my personal view, my personal feelings and senses. When I enter the store and see a new shiny guitar, and mostly such guitars in our stores are at cheap or mid-range costs, I don't feel a desire to play them. They are made like furniture. They are covered with polyester varnish, I know it. The second important issue of understanding Relic is that it elevates the rank of the instrument. I mean, if we see a man with a new instrument, we understand that this man started to play not long ago. He has recently bought it at a store and possibly for a low price. Even a new Gibson guitar, if you look closely, most new Gibson guitars do not differ at all from their cheap fellows. Yes, they sound better than Chinese copies, but nevertheless they look similar. That's why a new guitar for me is associated with a cheap Chinese copy or counterfeit. Or with the guitar for beginners. Professional musicians will not keep a guitar shiny or new. It's nonsense. It doesn't happen like this. If a musician plays a guitar for a year and it still has no wear, he plays badly. Or he does not play at all. Or he's afraid of the instrument, or he's afraid to scratch it. That's wrong. If you are a musician, you use the instrument as an instrument, not as a shiny picture on the wall. Relic is another case. Relic reproduces the soul of the guitar, not just a painted wood under shiny varnish. Relic has a beauty of painting. I'm an artist. I grew up focused on paintings. I visited museums. I studied architecture. It's close to me. When I come to the museum and watch masterpieces, I see not just a composition and colors, I see a painting, a texture, I see a time stamp left on the painting that has already become a part of this painting. When I was studying painting, we often analyzed and reviewed the works of Dutch artists. They're still lives. And I noticed an interesting detail. All Dutch artists of that time, making still life, used special technical tricks that helped them to achieve an extraordinary realism. There was a very specific technology of how to paint with oil fish scales, for example. They did it amazing. It was like a photo, hyperrealism. And they were so successful and so loved by people that we still admire their masterpieces. I apply this understanding of technology that helps to achieve such realism in relicking guitars. Relic starts with mixing colors to cover a naked guitar. It's a basement. After fading, aniline dyes have to obtain a desired shade and intensity. They do not fade away totally, but start to reflect light in another way. That's why when you look at the guitar from the side, the color of the varnish will change a bit. I use varnishes of different thickness and hardness, not to interfere with wood resonance. Lately, Krakelu will help with it. Dings and checks need to be at right places, exactly where hands, picks, or belt buckle contact with the instrument. Krakelu net on the varnish needs to have a proper tracery, the same as if it was done with time. Sudden freezing with varnish with CO2 is not the right way. Cracks become chaotic and do not influence either voice or look. Everything needs to be as true as possible. If something is not true, I'd say I don't believe it. It needs to be a symbiosis of accuracy and chaos. In ancient times, Chinese called it Dao, yin and yang harmony. If a relic is not improbable, a man carrying it and looking at it will say, I don't believe it. Yeah, it's not a true relic. And when my guitar is picked by a man and he says, wow, man, this guitar is so old, and I say, yo, man, it's a new guitar, I built it a month ago, and he says, you're kidding, no way. This is pleasant for me. A man believed his eyes, he believed my work, and he believed that this relic is true, made with time. When I took my first steps in guitar experiments, I noticed very clearly that a guitar with cracked varnish sounds better than a guitar with new varnish. And I asked myself, why is it so? It's quite simple. If we have a look at the water surface on a lake, we'll see small ripples even when the lake is calm. If we throw a stone in the water, we'll get waves, and small ripples remain on these waves. The same thing happens when we play guitar. The string makes a big wave, then it transforms into smaller waves, and here appear harmonics that are transmitted to wood. The wood reproduces this resonance and transmits it back to strings. So the whole guitar construction resonates with these harmonics. To get them back to the strings through the wood correctly, and to swing this resonance further. We need the punish that doesn't interfere with this process. Imagine that you covered a tuning fork with a plasticine or clay. It will not sound. Even if we cover a tuning fork with a thick layer of varnish, it will not sound. But this varnish dries and cracks. The tuning fork will start to sound. Why? Because cracked varnish can move together with waves of small resonance on the surface. And this issue is very important. And when I hear phrases like, I don't like cracks, I like shiny varnish, I ask one question. Do you like the sound of your guitar? If you like the sound of your guitar, you have to do anything to make this sound complete. Make it absolute. And cracks on the varnish help to do it like no other. The varnish protects the wood, but at the same time it works together with wood resonance. It adds so much transparency to the sound that I was amused when taking experiments. It's a miracle. That's why all the guitars that I have now are with cracks. And I'm happy with it. A guitar for me is a canvas. First I apply color, then cover it with varnish, and then I make a texture. This texture adds more depth to the color and varnish. When I was studying at my drawing classes and a nude was standing in front, we had to draw a naked girl. After some classes, we were looking at this girl like as if it's a closet or furniture. We just draw her. A shoulder, a knee, a buttock. For us, it was a model. That's all. Nothing more. But when we look at a girl which is slightly dressed, we are overwhelmed, because our brains fill in the blanks with some details. The same thing happens when I explore ancient paintings, explore frescoes of the 10th or 20th century. They survive not more than 20 to 40%. Everything else is wiped out. The paint fell off, left paint is covered with cracks, and this thing attracts us. We fill in the blanks with guesses about what was there under the patina layer, what was there when it was fresh, when an artist just made this fresco. The same thing happens to relic. The guitar becomes more interesting for us visually, aesthetically, when we look at it and see not only a nice wood covered with pretentious yellow color and pretentious shiny varnish, but we see a wood that has chaotic and wavy structure, that has mineral inclusions, that has darkening, it darkened with time. The varnish is cracked. Cracks got oxides. Patina appeared. This variety of factors provides the depth, the interest for us, that we can look at it infinitely, at least me. As for me, any old, vintage, rusty piece of iron or wood is a source of incredible information. You can find anything there, especially with magnifying glass. That's why a relic for me is an art. And my approach to relic is similar to the approach of making a fresco or painting. These approaches do not differ for me. The same research that I use exploring frescoes or icons or paintings, the same experience I apply here to the guitars. It's a kind of the second track of my creative activity. Why does everyone now choose nitrocellulose varnish? What is it good for? There is a huge variety of varnishes of different types. Two component, polyurethane, oil, alkyd, and polyester ones that allow to achieve awesome results in finishing and glossiness. And modern guitar fabrics use them a lot. They cover guitar with two-component varnish. It's hard, it's flexible, it stays for a long time, nothing happens to it, no solvent can harm it. Neither acetone or B52 or anything else, possibly napalm can do it. Hoxo really can. Only hoxo and grinder, that's all. Even a heater cannot do it to polyester. It's very hard. And I do not take guitars covered with this stuff for refinishing or relic, as it's not worth my time. But the finish is perfect. It's perfectly flat, even with a thick layer up to 3 millimeters. But this varnish does not give anything to the guitar voice. It kills the voice. Just imagine, a guitar in a plasticized jacket or shell. Will it sound? No way. Possibly it will with active pickups, but any log will sound with them. It's just a matter of taste what music to play on this log. But we are now talking about classic electric guitars that are being played with clear sound, crunch or light overdrive. Do you know why? The voice of such guitars contains not only the voice of pickups and the voice of the amp, but also the voice of the wood, because old PAF pickups obtain a microphonic effect that allows us to hear the voice of wood. Modern active pickups cannot say the same. Nitro varnish appeared as a replacement of shellac in furniture production. Shellac is a waste product of a special type of bedbugs living on trees. This waste product is gathered and then diluted with alcohol. Then it is divided into some layers with more or less walks, and using special technology is applied to wood. This procedure is quite difficult, time-consuming, long. This varnish is polished well, and at all, it is easy to work with. There were other types of varnishes, nail polish, acrylic pistachio, which were used by artists. Violinists were making their own varnishes with their own recipes, to get moderately viscous, moderately stringy, uncrackable, as cracks are defects. Cracks lead to refuse, yeah. And here nitro varnish appeared. A chemical varnish, incredibly unhealthy, although cheap. Really cheap. It became popular. It was used to cover cars, it was used to cover furniture, it started to be used to cover guitars because it was a new varnish and it allowed to make production cheap. But we see that eventually nitro varnish starts turning yellow under UV light. It becomes fragile, starts to crack, and later it was replaced with acrylic varnish, two-component varnish, polyurethane one. Basically, this nitrocellulose varnish consists of calyxylene, nitrocellulose mixed with thinners and solvents and plasticizers, so that a varnish after drying does not crack. Erosin can be a plasticizer, even polyurethane can be a plasticizer for nitrocellulose varnishes. Some nitrocellulose varnishes contain polyurethane as a plasticizer. So it becomes sometimes hard to distinguish if it's a polyurethane varnish or a nitrocellulose one, although they are almost identical in their characteristics. Polyurethane varnish is just a bit easier to work with. It cracks less and is more viscous. I use very hard nitrocellulose varnish. Production technology is quite simple. All ingredients are heated in one tank and then mixed for a long time. It's just harmful and it requires special conditions. There was a time when I made experiments and was mixing this varnish by myself, and I understood that I'd better be healthy. So, nitrocellulose is the cheapest varnish that was used to cover guitars, as well as furniture. But, as I've already mentioned, further cracks on it took effect and the varnish began to sound better than any other varnish used for guitars. Thin layer, cracks, nothing can stop the wood from moving in harmony with resonance, with strings. In fact, a guitar covered with nitro varnish sounds like or almost like a guitar not covered at all. So that's the story about the nitro varnish. It is relaxed nicely, it adds a kind of charm to the instrument, it sounds. And if you have an opportunity, I highly recommend refinishing your guitar with nitro varnish. Shellac is also good. It also sounds, just the technology differs, though characteristics are similar as well as finishing process. I line them up regarding sound, shellac and nitro varnish. Any varnish requires knowledge how to apply it and what characteristic it has. The same story here with color. It shouldn't be changed with time after production. It is considered as a flaw. Any color has its own stability. It is fairly considered that the less the color changes under UV light, the better it is. I partly agree with it. The dye must be durable. Light-resistant dye is a quality assurance, and the price depends on it. There are cheaper but less light-resistant dyes being used by some manufacturers. Like the Gibson factory those days. For about 18 months they used dyes with low light-resistant characteristics. It happened in 1959. In 1960, they corrected their mistake and started to use the right dyes according to production requirements. But from the whole line of vintage Burst, only guitars produced in 1959 delight us with a variety of shades. Those fragile dyes partly created that legendary look that we love. Many professionals from custom shop departments of Gibson and Fender companies quickly understood the value of relic and launched new lines of artificially relicked guitars. They use hard nitro varnishes, aniline dyes, oxidized or rubbed metallic parts, yellowed plastic ones. Guitars are applied with low temperatures, strong UV lamps and vibrations to play the wood and relieve the tension, to open up the resonance and tune it to proper frequencies. There are many ways to get a realistic vintage look, and such guitars sound amazing and are very comfortable to play. These guitars are valued by collectors and professional players who respect traditions and history of vintage instruments. Over the years, the army of relic lovers grew up, as well as proficiency of the builders who continue applying artificial relic. For many of them, it became a philosophy and art. Thanks for staying with me and for watching this video to the end. I'm waiting for your comments. And for those who still haven't subscribed, I advise to push the magic button and the bell to stay tuned to new videos on this channel. That's all for today. Thank you.
Rock and roll for all.